us all.
So we want to welcome everybody that's here tonight. This is Maundy Thursday service, also called the Service of Shadows. And this is always one of my favorite services throughout the year because we remember and get relevance as to why we are served communion, why we celebrate the sacrament of the church. And the fact that, you know, Jesus used this as the Last Supper. So I invite you to stand. In Matthew 11:28-29 says, "Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest for your souls." So join with us as we come into our first worship song and celebrate the fact that we come to the communion.
Oh, what a Savior!
Earthly confidence, it's only by your blood. Please be seated.
Pray with me, please. God, thanks for welcoming us here tonight as friends. Because, Father, there certainly are times in our life when we look at our lives in all totality and there's this understanding of our sin and we certainly don't feel like we've been a great friend to you. But thank you, O God, for reaching out to us when we didn't know enough to reach out to you. Thank you, O God, for claiming us. Thank you, O God, for calling us your own. Thank you for making a way back to you. And thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, we honor you tonight. We are so grateful to you for your willingness to suffer and die for our sins that we might be reconciled back to the Father, forgiven, ransomed, and reconciled back to the Father. Thank you for the new life that gives to us. But tonight, Lord Jesus Christ, we just want to recognize that sacrifice and the extent to which you were willing to go to bring us back home and make us who we always needed to be. So we thank you for that. God, we pray your presence in this place tonight in a very powerful way. And thank you for meeting us here and blessing this service. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd like to share a passage with you tonight. It comes from Mark's Gospel. You just saw a few bits of it on the screen a minute ago. It's Mark chapter 15, and it says this, verse 33. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And at 3 p.m, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? When some of those standing near heard this, they said, listen, he's calling Elijah. Someone ran, filled a sponge with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to take him down, he said. They had a tradition for that. With a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. The curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion who stood there in front of Jesus saw how he died, he said, surely this man was the Son of God. Friends, these are our Bibles. This is God's word, which has been given to us and gifted to us as always. May God's word be alive in this place and in every heart today as well. Amen. I'm willing to bet that in your house or in houses in which you've lived in the past, you've had some kind of window covering. Now, I'm not a decorator, so just stick with me for a few moments. If you've had window coverings of any kind, they may have been blinds. If they were blinds, they may have been vertical blinds or horizontal blinds. There was probably a size to the blind themselves. They may have been normal size blinds or the little mini blinds. The blinds may have been made of plastic or wood or aluminum or maybe some other material, but blinds are a pretty common window covering. If you haven't had blinds, maybe you've had shades, and there are all kinds of types of shades. There's the Roman shades and the cellular shades and the kind that fold up real kind of pretty. And shades tend to block out a little bit more than blinds do. Maybe you've had shades as window coverings at some point in time in your life. Maybe you know somebody who had drapes. Grandma had drapes, big, heavy, thick ones. Drapes, and with your drapes, there's almost always a valance at the top. If you really like your privacy, you might just go for shutters on the windows. But at some point in time, you've had curtains. And maybe the curtains were kind of light fabric, maybe heavier, maybe they were the sheer kind that the light could come through. You've probably seen curtains before, but oh, friends, you've never seen a curtain like this. So let's do a little history lesson. When the people of Israel first left Egypt and were brought out into the desert, God wanted them to have a church, a special kind of facility where they could go and have their worship services. So they did just that. And because they were still mobile, because they were nomads, because they were moving from place to place, God made sure that they had a church that they could take with them. It was called the tabernacle. In their language, the word tabernacle meant dwelling place, which is really kind of cool. It was God's reminder of way of saying, please remember, I dwell in that place. I'm living there. This is my home too. So whenever they entered the tabernacle, they had to remind themselves that God was dwelling there. And they used that tabernacle for years, that big tent, and they took it with them in all different kinds of places. But when they finally crossed the river, when they finally made it into the promised land, Israel, and when they had a capital city called Jerusalem, God finally told a man named Solomon, hey, it's time for something more permanent. Let's build us a church, a real one. And this time we're going to call it the temple. And we're going to make it out of some great big limestone blocks. And it'll be this massive structure. Then you're going to have a permanent facility to come and worship me in. So they built the temple. And if you read back through your Bible, God must really like details. Because God gave them ideas of materials they were supposed to use and dimensions right down to the nitty-gritty. And God told them exactly what he wanted that temple to look like. And on the inside of that temple, it was really just kind of a big old rectangular room, really tall, about 60 feet tall, but just a big rectangular room. And God says, I want you to call this rectangular room the holy place. Oh, if you like the word tabernacle, you'd like the word holy place even better, because that's a great reminder that God's dwelling there. It's a holy place. But down at the end of that big old rectangular room, God says, we're going to cordon off a little portion of that room, and we're going to call that the most holy place. So when you come to church and you come in the doors, you're standing in the holy place. But all the way down at the end of that hall-like room, there's a special area called the most holy place. And they had this big treasure chest that they called the Ark of the Covenant. And it had the Ten Commandments in there and some other items. They put that treasure chest in the most holy place. And there's only one person who could go into that area. It was the high priest. He only went in there every now and then and always went in there with incense and sacrifices of blood and other things. That was a special place. Well, if you've got a holy place and then a most holy place, we need something to separate the two. God could have said, I would like you to build me a wall between the two, just to make sure that common folks don't go into the most holy place. It's only the priest that goes in there. So you build yourself a wall and put a door in there and put a lock on the door and make sure there's only one key. And you give it to that high priest so that he's the only one who can get through there. God could have said, build that wall. But God didn't tell him to build a wall. God says, I want you to separate holy from most holy with a curtain. And this was some curtain. Remember, the ceiling inside that holy place, most holy place, was 60 feet tall. And God said, I want the curtain to extend from the ceiling all the way down to the floor. So that curtain was 60 feet tall. By the way, the peak in this room right here is 46 feet. So you got to go 15 feet beyond that to find the top of that curtain. That room was 30 feet wide. So that curtain had to span 30 feet. So now you've got the dimensions of the curtain already, right? 60 feet by 30 feet, huge curtain. It was made out of yarn that came from goat's hair. I know you don't have a curtain like that in your home. And the goat's hair was dyed blue and purple and scarlet. And it had like these embroidered cherubim angels on it. It must have been this incredible work of art. The kind of thing that today you would pay good money to go see in a museum to say, wow, that is so beautiful. And it hung from some kind of a rod up there on these big, solid gold clasps, 50 of them. So the clasps are fairly close together. They had to be because that curtain must have been incredibly heavy. I don't know what they used for a rod, but they didn't get that off the rack down at Target or something. That rod must have held up that incredible curtain. But whenever people came into the temple all those years, the first thing they saw when they walked in the door was that curtain. And their thought might have been, wow, this is so beautiful. But then they were immediately presented with the thought of, yeah, but I can't go past that. That curtain tells me I don't belong beyond there. Because this might be the holy place, and that feels pretty good. But that's the most holy place, and that's where the ark is. And that's when Mr. High Priest gets to go back there. And that's where God is really dwelling. So God put that curtain up. As pretty as it may be, and as impressive a work at ours as it is, God put that curtain up to say, we're going to keep a little distance between us. You stay back there, and I'll stay in here. And that high priest, he's going to go behind the curtain, and he'll have the services, and he'll come back and tell you what happened back there. But that's as close as you can get. So you can come to the holy place, but oh, no. You've got to keep a little distance between me and you. Let's just keep it that way. I don't know about you, but something feels kind of wrong in me with that kind of a worship service. Like saying, you can only get this close to God. And oh, by the way, that pretty curtain, it's a reminder of the fact that you can't go there. You just stay here. Until Jesus was born. They had that temple for a long, long time, and people stared at that curtain all of their lives. And then Jesus was born. And pardon me, I think when Jesus was born, that curtain started to fray a little bit. It's just my own thinking. But come on, when Jesus was born, prophets were calling him things like Emmanuel, which means God with us. And they were using terms like Lord, he will save his people from their sins. He is the Prince of Peace. They were using terms like that to describe Jesus even while he was a baby. I think the curtain's starting to fray just a little bit. It's coming down someday. And then Jesus grows up, and one of the first things that takes place at his ministry is he goes out into the desert, and there's a baptism ceremony. And when he's baptized in the Jordan, it says the Holy Spirit came down upon him like a dove, and there's this voice from heaven, the voice of God saying, that's my son. And I think the curtain frayed a little more. And then Jesus starts his ministry. And in my mind, every miracle causes that curtain to fray just a little bit more. Every teaching, every person who says, I believe, that curtain's coming down a little bit at a time. There's that day in Caesarea Philippi where Jesus says to his disciples, who do you think I am? And Peter stands up and says, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. That curtain's starting to fray even more, friends. And every time a life gets changed, that curtain's fraying even more and even more until Jesus gets arrested and he gets executed. And there's that place in the story where Jesus, as he's breathing out his last breath, what does it say about the curtain? The curtain in the temple was what? It was torn from top to bottom. Now, how did it get 60 feet tall? How did it get torn from top all the way to the bottom unless somebody at the top is starting to rip it first because nobody down here could have started up there? How in the world did that curtain get torn? That's God's way of saying, now the barrier's gone. Do you remember Jesus saying to his disciples last night of his life, I no longer call you servants because a servant doesn't know what his master is doing. I call you friends, and friends don't need curtains, do they? Friends say, now we're friends, and now we're together. There's a part of me when I was reading that story this past week, I thought, wow, that curtain is so incredibly beautiful. God, why didn't you just tell him to take it down, fold it up, and put it in a museum someplace? It's so pretty. Because it's God's way of saying, I don't ever want that curtain used again. I don't want you digging that thing out of mothballs and putting it up, thinking that there needs to be something between the two of us. No, 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 no. We're never going to put that curtain up again. Because when Jesus died for you, that curtain was torn. That curtain was torn so it could never be used again, so that never again would there be some pretty embroidered goat's hair thing that would stand between you and God or anything else. Have you read the book of Hebrews? Hebrews 9 tells us that Jesus, our great high priest in the heaven, went behind the curtain once for all as the most high, into the most holy place and offered a sacrifice of his own blood. You don't need a curtain anymore. By Jesus' death on the cross, that curtain is gone forever. And that's God's way of saying every last barrier between the two of us, as pretty as it might have been, every last barrier's gone. I did everything necessary so that you and I could be friends again. Been forgiven. You've been ransomed and redeemed. And now God wants to make us reconciled. And if that means that curtain gets torn, then God said, let's start tearing that curtain apart. Because I don't want anything to come between you and me.
Some lives demand shameful sin placed on him, the hope of every man. Oh, the blood of Jesus washes me. Oh, the blood shed for me. What a sacrifice to save my life. blood, it is my victory. Save your son, Holy One, slain so I can live. See the Lamb, the great I am, who takes away my sin. Oh, the blood washes me. Oh, the blood of Jesus shed for me. What a sacrifice that saved my life. Yes, the blood, it is my victory. Sin, yes, even then he shed his blood for me. Oh, the blood of Jesus washes me. Oh, the blood of Jesus shed for me. The blood, it is my victory. What a sacrifice that saved my life. Yes, the blood, it is my victory.
Pray with me, please. Lord Jesus Christ, thank you again for being our great high priest, the high priest of the heavens, who can go behind any curtain, any division, any tool of separation, and make a sacrifice for sin that's once and for all time and lasting and changes lives. God, thank you for taking that curtain down. As pretty as it was, it separated us. And God, if we're still to this day putting curtains back up, finding things that we can put between the two of us to create a little distance there, feels a little safer for us, God, may you still be tearing down curtains because of what Jesus Christ has done and the manner in which he changed our life. His life is worth it. Every curtain gone. And God, we are so grateful that you give us a reminder of this love of Jesus Christ that we now have for ourselves, that we get to focus on his broken body and focus on the blood that was shed so that this gift of salvation is renewed in us again and again and again. Make us aware of our sin. We want to confess well before you tonight. Make us aware of our sin. And Jesus, thank you bringing us back home, and taking down every barrier. And we love you, and we pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Last night of his life, when he was with his disciples for the last time, sharing some of those last words back and forth, still teaching them about the kingdom and the life everlasting, to the very end, he wanted to give them a physical reminder of this incredible gift that he's giving to them. And so he said to them, after he had given thanks, "Take this bread. It is my body, which is broken for you. Do it as often as you eat it. In remembrance of me," meaning think about me and what I've done, my body broken for you willingly. Curtain's gone. And then he poured out a cup in front of them and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It's my blood shed for you. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me," saying in effect, every time you drink that cup, think about my blood poured out for you. It's a sacrifice for sins. The curtain's gone. Remember me. So friends, we invite you to celebrate this sacrament with us again tonight, the sacrament of communion. We're going to do it a little bit different tonight. We'll invite you to come to the front, but you'll all come down the center aisle here and receive the bread here, and then proceed to the next aisles out where you'll receive the juice, and then circle back around and back to your seats that way. So we'll create a little traffic flow this way. And you'll have the bread and the juice. Again, once you've taken the juice and the bread, you can go anywhere that you'd like and celebrate the sacrament, whatever is most meaningful to you. And friends, come, for all things have now been made ready. Thank you.
stand and join with us in this last song.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Shall the weakness watch and pray, find in me thine all in all.
Debt paid, every shred of that curtain gone, because God wouldn't have it any other way. When Jesus said, I no longer call you servants, I call you friends, he really meant it, and he found ways to erase every shred of that curtain, gave his life for you, every sin forgiven, ransomed, redeemed, reconciled. Now you're home. Friends, go and live that reality, recognizing that our sin required that death of Jesus Christ, but his resurrection gives us life again. Go and live that reality this coming week. And as you leave this place tonight, may you take with you God's grace and his mercy and his peace. Go in peace.